Mike. We're live? All right, what's up everyone? I'm Dan Casey and we are here live at the Crow's Nest with something very special for you. Anyone who tuned in yesterday knows what's about to happen. I'm looking at the wrong camera. That's how special this is. I'm overwhelmed by what we're about to do. Guys, we're live at the Crow's Nest and we're about to hear some sweet, sweet tunes because I think we can all agree one of the best parts of playing Guild Wars is the awesome music that fills your ears while you're questing all across Tyria. And I'm here today with McLean Deemer, an ArenaNet composer, and his Merry Minstrels. So, McLean, first of all, thank you for being here, man. Thank you for coming back.
It's my pleasure.
So, tell the people at home a little bit about what they're going to experience today.
Yeah, so, like you said, the music is something that's extremely important to almost all the fans. I would hope all the fans. And, you know, my kind of role as the composer at ArenaNet is to act as the steward of the music that came before me and to continue the musical vision going forward. And we decided, instead of trying to replicate the kind of epic orchestral feel, we do something a little different. And I put together with my friends Amin Zarukian and Caitlin Wolfberg a program that kind of spans the whole arc of Guild Wars 2 music from launch until the Heart of Thorns, really.
So this is like Guild Wars plays the hits.
Exactly. This is basically a greatest hits, Guild Wars 2.
Fantastic. I can picture the infomercial right now with all the late night. You got Donny Osmond hosting.
Such hits as.
Yeah. No spoilers.
Yeah.
Awesome. So you are the composer. You're hard at work right now, or you've been hard at work at Heart of Thorns.
I'm extremely hard of work.
Yes.
I'm extremely hard at work, and this has been a nice break, but it's starting tomorrow, I got to go back, and it's kind of the home stretch until the release of the game.
Well, there's a light at the end of the tunnel, but in the meantime, we're going to hear some
light.
Awesome jams, so with that said, I'll let you guys take it away.
Great, thanks so much.
Awesome, thank you. All right, that was fantastic, guys. Nice tour down. Those were some older songs, if I'm not mistaken, correct? Those were ones composed by Jeremy Soule?
Yes. So what? Obviously, we had to start with the Guild Wars theme, which stretches all the way back to Prophecies.
Yeah.
And then I wanted to do a couple of the racial themes, and we can't do them all because there's too many.
Exactly. We'd be here all day.
We'd be here all day. Isn't the day long enough?
Yeah.
So we decided to do the Saga of the Norn and the Char, which I think are two of the strongest in terms of melody, and they're just fun to play, you know?
Yeah. What about those two themes in particular speak to you as a musician?
Well, they both have great feels. So the Saga of the Norn has this great kind of adventurous feel and this big, bold theme that in the original is played on French horns, and then here, of course, is played by the violin, but it's just instantly recognizable. It makes you want to kind of conquer these frosty peaks and go adventuring. And then the Char is just so sinister, you know. It might be a little bit boring for the bass because it's just kind of you sit on a D for the whole thing, but it's just got a really great kind of dark vibe to it that's really fun to play.
That's awesome. So what's the challenge in sort of reinterpreting these tunes for a three-piece outfit for you?
It's a crazy challenge because, especially with Jeremy's music, he's so advanced as a composer and a musician. He's incredibly talented, and his pieces are harmonically very complex. So, you know, to strip down a massive orchestra with a choir and percussion and piano and all this stuff to just the core, right, which is sort of melody, harmony, and then bass. And the truth is, there's no rhythm instrument up here, there's no percussion, there's no drummer, so Amin actually has to take care of 90% of the rhythmic stuff.
Good job.
And he's doing an amazing job. So to find those core elements, like what is the most important piece of this? Is it, what's the melody, what's the rhythm feel that we want, and what are the chords, you know, that's kind of my job. is very difficult, you know, and to do it justice, to get it, does this still feel like true to the original, you
exactly.
know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, fantastic. And I know that we have a fan favorite coming up. I'm not going to say what it is now. They'll figure it out pretty quickly.
Yeah, I think anyone who knows this song will recognize it immediately.
Awesome. So with that said, I'll let you guys take it away.
Thanks so much.
Now, who doesn't love a little Fear Not this night? That's fantastic.
Thank you.
So why do you think that song in particular resonates so much with the Guild Wars audience?
Well, it's kind of the... it's sort of like the B-side of the theme, right? So when you play through the entire story campaign and you defeat Zaitan at the end of the core game, it's the song that plays as you kind of reconnect with all the iconic heroes and the credits start to roll. And you know, that's a very emotional journey just to get to that point. It's a major commitment for any player. And as you get close to that point, there's little bits and pieces in the story where the melody is hinted at, you know, and then this full-blown song with singing and everything plays at the very end, and it's just like seeing a movie. It's like the final credits roll, and you hear that big emotional song at the end, so it's connected with a lot of fans.
Yeah, and I think it was nice to hear this version as well, sort of stripped down. You don't have the vocals, but you have, you know, that sort of intimacy of a three-piece ensemble.
Yeah, and of course, Caitlin is just, you know, a lovely, lovely player, so she manages to convey that same sense of emotion that we usually get with the vocals.
Fantastic. So tell us a little bit about what we have coming down the pipeline. It's about to get a little spooky in here, if I'm not mistaken.
It gets a little spooky. I know we're kind of jumping the gun. It's still September, but...
Listen, you can buy candy corn in literally any store in America right now, so it's not too early.
I started to see Halloween-branded candy in August this year, which is the earliest I've ever seen it.
Come on. It's not even cold yet.
Yeah. So after the initial game shipped, ArenaNet has a history of doing holiday-based content, going back to the first game. So they wanted to do something special, and they released the very first holiday that was coming up after the game released was Halloween, which is a big holiday for players. And of course, it needed a new soundtrack, and this was kind of my first opportunity to really write new music for Guild Wars. So I decided it needed that kind of Danny Elfman, spooky but funny vibe, you know, because that's the art was very much in that same vein, and so is the kind of content that you know that came out then.
Awesome. Are there any plans for a new Meat-toberfest theme?
There was a big Meat-tober. I had a song like in the can, and it was going to be awesome, and. It's somewhere. Someday that'll get released.
It's marinating.
Yeah,
being dry aged
exactly.
Right now,
for years,
just in time.
Decades that song is gonna marinate. It's gonna be amazing.
Great. Well, I'll let you guys get to it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
That was
I know.
That did not happen yesterday. That was a nice improvement. Tell us a little bit about what the that letter tune was, and also, is that a lute that you were just holding?
Wait
for it. Wait for it. There we go.
No, that was not a lute.
It wasn't a lute.
It was a mandolin.
Ah.
Sorry, what was the question before that?
let's just go with that. Tell us about the mandolin.
Sure. So this song is actually really fun. There's kind of a long story, so I'll see if I can give a brief version, but at 2010 in Gamescom in Germany, mm-hmm. it was the first playable demo of Guild Wars 2 ever, right? And one of our designers, a guy named Matthew Moore, he has a penchant for writing these kind of goofy songs. And in order to staff the game with players for the German, you know, kind of fan base, everyone from ArenaNet had to come into the studio to play, but on German time. So we were doing this graveyard shift for a week, and we're kind of losing our minds. And he was in Germany, and he wrote this song. One of the events that we had to repeat over and over was fighting this dragon. So he wrote this song called Bash the Dragon, uh-huh. about us staying up at midnight, bashing this dragon like every 5 minutes. So fast forward a couple years. We're doing an in-game festival called the Dragon Bash, and I thought, oh, this song would be so perfect, but we should rewrite it as if it's like a pub song that people in the game would sing. Like every year when the Dragon Bash festival comes mm-hmm. around, somebody sort of like stamps their stein on the table and starts kicking up the beat, and then everybody sings along, and it was amazing. He rewrote the lyrics, and they were even better. We managed to get almost the entire studio to, in one of our weekly meetings or monthly meetings, to do these kind of stomps and claps that mm-hmm. I put into the recording. And then we assembled kind of a strike team of all the best singers in the studio to do this group sing-along. And it's amazing. I mean, you can hear it on the ArenaNet SoundCloud. The final version is awesome. I love it.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
So as I understand it, coming up next, we're going to crack open the Super Adventure Box.
The Super Adventure Box. So another fan favorite. For April Fool's in 2013, we kind of put this pseudo-retro Guild Wars 2 game we put some, you know, kind of marketing material out there as a joke, and the actual joke was that it was a real game that you could play on April 1st, and another huge hit with the fans, and of course it had to have a retro-inspired soundtrack to go along with it. So we're going to do another greatest, a very select greatest
yes.
hits from Super Adventure Box.
The greatest of the greatest.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Maximum
awesome.
Greatness.
Awesome, guys. Well, I'll let you take it away.
Thanks.
Not too slow this time, right?
All right. Always love some good old-fashioned Super Adventure Box jams. Are there, is there any Super Adventure Box stuff maybe coming down the pipeline for Heart of Thorns that you could tell us about, perhaps, maybe?
Nothing that I can tell you about, because I don't know anything.
Okay.
I don't know anything,
I swear.
He
doesn't know anything.
But,
wink.
I wish it would come back.
Yeah.
Out of my control, unfortunately.
Of course.
But I'd love an excuse to write some more music for it, so.
Yeah.
If somebody out there is listening.
Well, speaking of writing music, how did you first get into composition for games?
Yeah, well, before I got into composition, I was a sound designer, and that's actually how Amin and I met. We used to work at another game studio in Boston many moons ago, and I kind of thought that that was going to be my trajectory, right? Mm-hmm. And I love doing it, obviously, and I ended up moving to Seattle in 2010 to work at ArenaNet as a sound designer. And I worked on the game as a sound designer all the way until it shipped in 2012. And then that's kind of when the decision was made to bring composition in-house. Right before then, it had all been done by Jeremy Soule.
Gotcha.
Going back to the first game. And I was actually tasked with, you know, kind of finding the person to do it. And I thought, well, you know, I'm right here. Like, let me do it. And you know, to their credit, to everyone at the studio's credit, it worked out really well, and it continues to work out well. I hope.
Yeah, I'll say.
Yeah, but that's kind of it. I sort of backed into it.
Awesome.
So I didn't think I would ever get this opportunity, and here I am.
How did being a sound designer on the game first inform your composition work?
Well, the thing that a lot of people don't realize about writing music for games is that you have to really know the tech that runs the game, right? The game engine. You don't just sort of write music and throw it over the fence. I mean, you can do that, but that's how people did it in like 1998, right? It's like things are a little more advanced now.
Mm-hmm.
So knowing how the game engine works, and all of our internal tools and all the teams and all that is a massive advantage, because I can walk right over to a designer and say, what's this level that you're working on? And what can I do to help you musically? So being in internal to the company is a huge benefit, I think. And so to answer your question for real, knowing every aspect of how the game is made and being a part of it, the audio team, is very important, I think.
Yeah, well, having a collaborative environment like that, it must be a lot easier to get questions answered than like being halfway across the country.
Exactly.
Awesome. Well, tell us a little bit about what we have coming up next.
Yeah, so last year, we were kind of continuing our cadence of post-ship releases for, it's called The Living World, and we did a year of Living World Season 1, and then we took a break and we came back with Living World Season 2, and I thought that during that break, I kind of made the argument that in order to really elevate the quality of the release, that we should try to do some live music instead of just computer-based, you know, digital samples.
Yeah.
Because a human being playing an instrument is much better than a machine, right?
Yeah, take that, machine.
Yeah, get out of here. So I made the case that we should do a live orchestra, and it was, again, just a big hit with the fans, and I think the music in the game is better for it. So this is sort of a block of music from Living World Season 2, and some of the greatest hits. Some of the
awesome.
Stuff I think
yeah.
sounds the best.
Keep the hits coming. Awesome,
only
guys.
Hits. Only the hits.
Yeah, of course.
No new stuff. Only the hits
for you guys. Yeah, that's all people want to hear.
Yeah.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
All right, so that's what happens when Mordremoth attacks the stream, but you know, thanks for bearing with us, guys. So we have one more song.
One more.
Before we bid adieu to everyone and kick it over to the next awesome stuff coming down the pipeline. But before we get into that, tell me, you've been hard at work at Hunter Thorns. I'm curious, when all is said and done, how long will it have taken you from concept to completion to actually compose it all?
That's a great question, and actually a very timely question, considering what we're playing next. The very first piece that I thought was going to be for Heart of Thorns, I wrote for the main theme, and that was like maybe a year and a half ago. Or 2 years ago?
Wow.
I think it was 2 years ago. And I ended up not using it. I used it for something else. And then I wrote another theme, and then I didn't like that. And then I wrote another theme, and I didn't like that. And I wrote another one, and I rewrote it. And what we're about to play, the official Heart of Thorns theme, is actually the fifth time I've tried to write the Heart of Thorns theme.
Fifth time's the charm. That's what they always say.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's been about 2 years. The majority of the music it's writing has been since the beginning of this year, mm-hmm. and a heavy amount of it has been since the spring. But yeah, it kind of first popped into my head about 2 years ago.
Fantastic. So this is the most current, and is this the final version of the Heart of Thorns theme?
This is McLean and the Minstrels' interpretation of the final fifth version of the main theme for Heart of Thorns.
Fantastic. Well, I will let you guys take it away, and thank you so much.
Thank you.